Despite all the hardship we endure these days as individuals, every statistic suggests that there is a hunger in the world to serve.
Welcome to Thrive On Live. I'm Caroline Modaresi-Tirani. AnnaSophia Robb is only 20 years old and she's already got over 20 television and film credits to her name. But aside from her acting success in Hollywood, Robb has made giving back one of her top priorities, and she joins me now to discuss her philanthropic efforts and her upcoming projects. So thanks so much for being here.
Thank you so much.
It's great to have you. So tell me, you know, that you've got this sort of partnership with Toms of Maine, you're working with their campaign. Tell me a little bit about it.
So Toms of Maine, I'm a fan of their products, and but they have this really cool program where they give back to their communities. So it's called 50 States for Good, and they give over $500,000 to grassroots nonprofits, and each state gets about $10,000, and they encourage the basically they just direct people to their website, and you can nominate any organization that is doing local awesome work in your community. And then they give $10,000 away. And it's like, it's such a cool idea. And I thought, what a way to give back.
It's an amazing thing. I mean, you grew up in Colorado, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in terms of your own kind of childhood and you know, the way that there were sort of these kind of programs, did you kind of get involved in the community when you were a kid? Did you go to like the local, you know, local dance hall or something like that?
I did. My mom was really involved with a lot of nonprofits when I was growing up. And I've been acting since I was about 9 years old. So I feel like the film community is also very involved in nonprofits and giving back and working for the greater good of humanity. Those are the projects that I like to be a part of. So I've always been sort of around that, and I thought I would love to work with organizations or companies that promote giving back. It's like a global awareness.
Yeah, you really do. I mean, I have to say it's surprising because when you sort of, you know, when anyone meets like a, you know, 20-year-old something film star, you think, oh, well, your Twitter timeline, your Instagram timeline will be full of you at a party or like, you know, sort of non-alcoholic beverage in your hand because you're only 20, but, you know, obviously, just sort of living it up, you know, having a whale of time. But, you know, this seems to be the sort of snapshot of your timeline. This is what tweet here. I like going out into communities and getting involved with families, building lasting and impacting relationships and growth. Not something I'd expect from a 20-year-old. Maybe I'm just not meeting the right 20-year-old. Is this kind of a thing for you? I mean, like, you know, are you sort of standing out among your friends? Your friends think, what are you doing? You're doing another activism thing?
I don't think I'm the only one. I honestly don't. I just don't think we give enough credit to young people. I mean, maybe I get uncomfortable. Like, I can't take selfies. I get really... And I'm like, I just don't like it. I like making funny faces, and I like posting things that matter. I think if it's a message board to the world, if you're basically saying, this is what I am, it's like, what do you want to leave? I mean, yes, you can delete your post, but like, leave it up there. That's what your legacy is. And so I'd like at least my Instagram or Twitter to be a place where people can go to say, you know, I feel like I haven't done much, or I want to get involved, or I felt like that when I was younger. I was like, well, I want to help out with this, but what do I do? Where do I go?
Sure.
I mean, I know you can look up, you know, tons of organizations online, but it's like, how do you know they're viable? How do you know what exactly you do? How do you know their impact? And so if I can at least help direct young people or people in general to ways that they can help other people, then that would be great.
Yeah, we've seen enough selfies for a lifetime. We probably don't need any more. So that's probably the better way around. Well, I've got a video comment here. This is a question from one of our HuffPost Live community members, Kimberly O'Neill, founder of The Giving Blueprint. Take a listen.
Cool.
Hi, this is Kimberly O'Neill, founder of The Giving Blueprint out of Dallas, Texas. And I have a question for you. Can you tell us why charitable giving and giving back is such an important part to your personal platform and how you incorporate that into your day-to-day activities within the entertainment industry?
That is a good question. Okay. I guess, how do I, like, live it day-to-day?
Yeah, I mean, you're such a busy woman. You know, you've got your sort of acting, Hollywood, balancing all of that, plus your activism. I mean, how do you do that?
I guess you, like anything, you make it a priority. I'd say I feel like I get a lot of opportunities, or I just, even on Twitter, I mean, social media makes it so easy. You just follow the right people online and you get posts, or you get pop-ups, or like PBS or NPR, or, figure out and just follow different journalists who write about different organizations, and you can get sort of pop-ups, and it's like, oh, bam, it's so easy. That's a cause I can help her. You know, this natural disaster just helped or happened in wherever in the world, like, oh, I can send aid, or Red Cross is doing something.
Social media to help. So you're a bit of a news junkie. You follow like NPR, PBS, journalists on Twitter. Are you a news junkie?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, a little bit. I mean, I go on every once in a while. I try to stay off my phone, but I think that's the easiest way on a daily basis that I can understand giving back. And just even retweeting. I think retweeting is sometimes, it's the easiest thing you can do. It's just getting that awareness.
Absolutely. So, well, we know you as a, you know, an actor, we know you kind of, you know, so, such a accomplished, we already said 20 titles, 20 TV and film titles already, which is kind of, which is crazy.
Amazing.
Yeah. Amazing. But, you know, I've got this Instagram photo. I want to show everybody this. This is AnnaSophia's Instagram. This is 4 months ago, heading to Capitol Hill without the creative C, time for Congress to value the arts. So tell me a little bit about that then. You sound a little bit political there.
Yeah, the Creative Coalition, I was there, I think it was in April maybe. I'm not, my sense of time is a little warped. But the Creative Coalition, we basically, I was invited this year, and they come every year to Capitol Hill, and they just talk, they lobby with the congressmen and our leaders on Capitol Hill of how important the arts are to the U.S. and that just for funding, and just that we need to value the arts and how important they are in education.
Yeah, do you think people aren't paying enough attention, or perhaps kind of like underestimate the arts maybe?
I definitely think people underestimate the arts. I think also there's a lot of pressure for STEAM, or STEM, I think is what it is. It's like science, technology, engineering, and
maths.
But what we want it to be is STEAM, which is, and the arts. Add that extra A.
I love
in
it.
In there. Yeah. And it, because I'm personally a creative person. I'm not great in maths and science, but I so respect people who are. But I think it's important to value those creative kids that can use their voice through storytelling, through arts, through acting, through theater, through whatever, to make the world a better place.
So, I mean, what inspires you to give back then? I mean, you seem so giving, you know, you're sort of on Twitter and on Instagram as well. What is it that inspires you to give back?
I feel like it's my duty as a person. I feel like I've been given so much and so many opportunities just living in the States and just growing up in an awesome family and being able to live out my dream every day and get an awesome education. And I think I'm taking this human rights class in school right now and just learning about our rights as people and that everyone has like, you know, just natural rights. And I think it's our duty as people to honor another person's life. And it's just, it becomes this cycle.
Yeah. I mean, you sound like you could be slightly political and maybe, I don't know, would you ever go into politics? I mean, obviously acting is taking up a big focus. And I know NYU is also, you know, on the books at the moment as well for you. What about politics? Do you think you would do that at some point?
Politics? Sure. But it would definitely be for like a nonprofit. I don't think it would be to represent like a political body.
You don't feel like Congress is calling for you?
No. I could be a lobbyist maybe, but
so you never run for office?
No. I'm too committed to acting, I think, to do that.
Well, I mean, and you know, you have been committed to acting. I want to just play another video comment before we move on to that. But this is from Greer Gates, the founder of My Jewels of Hope. Take a listen.
Hi, my name is Greer Gates, and I'm the founder of My Jewels of Hope, where I make and sell jewelry for cancer research. I started because a close family friend was diagnosed with ovarian cancer, and I was wondering how you find the charities that you're so passionate about.
That's a good, well, like I said, I look on Twitter a lot, and then also I feel like if you're open to it, they just come. Honestly, I think maybe it's also just being more in a spotlight.
Being in the public eye.
Being in the public eye, people ask me to be a part of things like Tom's of Maine reached out, and then I started researching. I was like, oh yeah, I'm a big fan of their, you know, their products anyway. I love the floss.
Yeah.
And their toothpaste.
Love that deodorant. No aluminium.
Yeah, exactly.
Aluminum, sorry.
Aluminum.
Yeah. Aluminum, forget where I am. Aluminum, yeah.
It smells like lavender. So I think that's why I tend to filter the more of the nonprofits that come to me and then post them online. But I like to retweet because I like to do some research to know that they're a good place to spend your time and your money.
I think it's a good point too. I want to show this this post. I don't know if we can see it. Yeah, there you go. I love this. This on the Who Say. You said Nesquik on the rise. So is childhood obesity. I love that. You know, you're kind of like very political in a lot of different arenas. So you know, does that scare you? Obviously, you know, you were saying about you're kind of conscious of what you're eating and stuff. But you know, does that sort of scare you? The idea of childhood obesity and the way that we're putting things in our body.
I think so. I mean, what you put in your body is so. This is a topic I'm really passionate about, but not necessarily. I don't know enough about it yet. But I think we just really need to be paying attention to what we put in our bodies. I mean, I think so many people think about how tired they are, why they can't lose the extra weight. I mean, when you're a kid, you don't worry about that. But like, you know, just why you're tired or why you can never wake up or why you keep taking naps or why you always need sugar or why you always need coffee. And it's like, the food that you put in is your momentum for tomorrow. My boyfriend says that. He's big into health.
Oh, he is?
Yeah. And so we talk about this a lot, but I think we just need to have a good education on where our nutrition is coming from and what our body needs, and listening to our bodies instead of what the grocery store gives us or what restaurants provide, but like really study, like, do you need to eat as much meat as you're eating, or are you more of a vegetarian type?
Are you a vegetarian? I mean,
I love meat. No, I love meat, but like I know I went off red meat for a little while just to test that out, and I realized I love meat. I need red meat.
It gives
me energy.
I'm all for the bacon as well, I have to say.
Me too.
Yeah.
But just understanding that and understanding and listening to your body and understanding the time of day you eat and how much you eat. My boyfriend is a health practitioner, so I'm learning a lot about that. But I think it's so important to teach our kids, start these sort of these routines when we're young, so that it's not so that when you're 30 and you're like, oh my gosh, why am I so overweight? Like, everyone's not freaking out, or you know, you have to feel like you have to work out. It's like, it's about maintaining a healthy lifestyle. It's not about how you look physically. It's about like your mental state.
Yeah. Well, you sound very kind of on it. I mean, I would say, to be in the world of Hollywood, where obviously, you know, from the outsider's perspective, everyone sort of thinks, gosh, they're all so obsessed with being skinny, or like you have to be skinny to get ahead. But you sound like you have a bit of more of a holistic approach to just sort of your health in general.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's all about first mental health and being healthy in your soul and your perspective, and then your movement. And like, I think exercise creates a healthy perspective. I was about to start school and I was freaking out just a couple weeks ago. And I literally, just running, got so much tension out.
Just go for a run.
Yeah, it's a big relief. I think movement creates positive energy.
So what were you freaking out about? I mean, the start of school and it, you know, cause I mean, this is amazing. I mean, NYU, congratulations, first of all. It's a great school. So what were you freaking out about?
Oh, I guess I was just, I was like, okay, I've got to. It's just a change of pace. It's just a mental shift, and I hadn't worked out in a while, so I was like, I just need to get some of that tension out. I have a lot of energy, and if I don't get it out, then it manifests itself in negative ways, and I tend to get tense.
Yeah, well, it's good. I mean, it's good. It's good to know what will sort of like work everything out for you. Well, let's talk a little bit about your career, because obviously we kind of danced around it a little bit, but you know, the Carrie Diaries was huge. It was such a big moment for you, and you know, I think so many people were really into it as well. And you know, it was kind of looking about obviously fashion, shoes, and you know. Do you think that there was a sort of juxtaposition or dichotomy for you where it was like, well, this was a show very much about sort of like fashion and that sort of thing, but you're such a person that likes to look outward and not at the superficial. Was that difficult for you?
No, it was a lot of fun. It was easy because I didn't have to decide what I was wearing. It was like, I just show up to work, I go in these fittings. It's about the clothes, it's a lot of fun. I mean, I think clothing is a form of self-expression. So I look at that as an art form as well. I remember, Fashion Week I find completely overwhelming, but I also love fashion. Like, it's so much fun. It's wearable art.
Yeah, we were talking about your shorts, which are fabulous as well.
Thank you.
Wearable art and stretchy.
Yeah, and stretchy.
You see, these are amazing. They're so cool.
It's Issa. Isa. I don't know how to say it.
Isa. Yeah, yeah. Lovely.
You're like, I know.
Yeah, Isa. No. It's just, well, she did Kate Middleton's dress when she was pregnant. So that's the only reason, really. All right.
And you're British.
Yeah. Well, and a British, exactly, yeah. But, I mean, you know, that's similar to Sarah Jessica Parker, because she's kind of a similar sort of person, right? I mean, did you talk to her about that? I know that you spoke before the Carrie Diaries, but she is very much a kind of like, I love fashion, but I will also look outward, and I'm okay to give my name to a cause or to work for a cause.
Yeah, I don't think the two are exclusive. I mean, we didn't talk about that. We haven't had many interactions, but she's a lovely person, and we have a lot of mutual friends in common, and I so respect her work and her sense of fashion is impeccable.
Oh yeah.
And I think there are a lot of cool brands like TerraCycle. They do more products, but there are different clothing brands that upcycle and recycle clothing, and I definitely believe in vintage clothes and reusing old clothes or doing clothes swaps. I think that's a great idea.
Do you do that with your friends? Do you guys do that?
I don't, because I'm so little and everyone's bigger than me. So it's a bit of an issue.
The perils. It is. I can imagine you just
being
like
small.
The perils of being smaller. I mean, yeah, of course. Well, I mean, let's talk about, you mentioned Sarah Jessica Parker. Let's talk about some other, amazing women that you've worked with. Alice and Janie. I mean, the way, way back. First of all, congrats. That film was fabulous. I mean, I don't think I've ever seen Steve Carell, first of all. I mean, his performance, your performance. I mean, Sam Rockwell, don't even. I'll start to blush now.
I blush too.
Yeah, let's not do it to ourselves. But, you know, I think it was a really great film. It was a real smart film. And, you know, Alice and Janie obviously must have been amazing to work with. I mean, what was she like? Did you kind of have was she a bit of a role model for you? Was she a bit of a mentor in that? Or?
Yeah, she did sort of have this maternal-like quality, and I just, I so respect her. She's just so smart. It's like that scene, I think you guys are playing a clip right then. She did that take a different time, every single take, a different way, a different energy or a different word or different mannerisms, and we did it all day long, just nonstop. That takes so much energy and intelligence. I have so much respect for comedians because you have to be on your toes. I saw The Trip to Italy last night. I don't think I've ever laughed so hard in a movie.
That's so funny. Yeah, Rob Brydon and Steve Coogan.
Yes, they're so talented. But like Alice and Janie and so many of the comedians in The Way, Way Back, I mean, they ground their work in that film. It's very grounded, but it just plays off of life.
Yeah,
really?
Absolutely. Well, I mean, I think that's a good point. And, you know, I like that what you said about Alison being kind of the maternal sort of figure. I mean, you know, is that important for you when you're on a film? Is it nice to have those kind of figures? I mean, did you feel like you could confide or, you know, sort of run through your own concerns with her?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it was more laid back. It was, I don't think, I had just graduated high school. It was my first film without my parents. And I don't think I really processed everything that was going on at that point. So just to be able to hang out with Allison and Rob Corddry and literally sit there and everybody's just talking and laughing and making jokes, it was really a special experience.
So it was like a fun set. Yeah, because what was Steve Carell like on that set? Because in the film, he plays this, like, he was kind of mean, I have to say.
Such a dick in that movie.
Yeah, he was a real dick in the movie. And, you know, I mean, was he funny again off camera, or what was he?
He's hilarious. First of all, he's hilarious. Second of all, he is such a gentleman. Such a gentleman. I mean, he holds the door open for everyone, lets them all go through, is so polite. Oh my gosh, he's the nicest guy in the whole world. Not to mention, he just brings so much energy to the set. I remember there's a dinner scene late at night. There's a big altercation, and Allison, it was like 3 a.m, and she had been doing her spiel, and she was exhausted. And she's like, Steve, help me out. And he just breaks into this big belly laugh. Just out of, like, on cue, is just laughing so hard. And I look over, and all of a sudden, everyone on set is just laughing at, like, 3:30 in the morning, because he's there, you know, he's there for Alice, and he's like, she needs energy, I'm gonna give it to her, even though that's not the sort of character that he's supposed to be playing in that, and he's just so generous.
So he's a gentleman throughout then. I mean, he's, you know, even when that's great. I love that he helps out in that way. I mean, who else would you want to work with? I mean, obviously you've got films coming up. I know you just wrapped one with, I think it was Famke Janssen and one of the Dakota's, De Niro's daughter. I can't remember her name. Dorina De Niro. Dorina De Niro. Or was it just Famke Janssen?
It was just Famke.
Famke Janssen. Yeah. Well, just Famke is just enough anyway. But, you know, Famke Janssen's amazing. I mean, obviously, we know her from The X-Men. I remember her from James Bond. But how would she like to work with?
She's an amazing woman. And she's an amazing woman. She's so beautiful. I would just catch myself staring at her. I'm like, oh, my gosh. You are so strikingly beautiful. And she's so intelligent. I mean, she's a writer, and she's adapting books into screenplays, and she has so many thoughts and opinions about the world and what she's doing. And it was a really collaborative film set, and it was awesome to be a part of that. And she also directs, so it was interesting to watch an actress who has also directed her films. And now she's acting in one, and just to see how she balances that, and just allowing the director to Janet Grillo is our director, and she just really allowed Janet to take control, obviously. But I would think that would be hard if you're used to directing your own.
Yeah, producers. Used to being kind of in charge as well. I can imagine it must be that sort of difficult. Well, who would you love to work with in Hollywood? Obviously, you've got, like, you know, you're young, you're talented. People seem to really love to work with you. You know, you've done all amazing projects already. You know, what's your dream? If I said, okay, I'll wave a magic wand and you can be in a film with so-and-so tomorrow.
Oh, I get so overwhelmed. I love Ewan McGregor. I mean, I had dinner with him the other night. It was at a dinner party, and I literally was sitting next to him, and I couldn't believe it. I was sitting there, and I was like, I cannot believe this in my head. And there's so many talented people. I'd love to try theater. I've never done theater before. I'd love to do a comedy. Well, The Way, Way Back is partly a comedy, but I think something like The Trip to Italy or The Mindy Project.
She was there. Yeah. I know. That's your shout out. This is your opportunity.
Hi.
Go for it. Yeah. Mindy, if you're still in the building. You know, AnnaSophia is here.
Yeah, I'm a fan.
Ready to work. I mean, well, I think that's great. Well, I want to read a comment. Rona Barry Morin says, giving back is recognizing the fact that we are all part of this community.
Yes.
We can all do something to help our fellow person. Mm-hmm. You know, kind of, we sort of touched on it a little bit, but I mean, how do you thrive? I mean, you know, what do you think that is sort of part of your life that makes you thrive?
What do I thrive? I definitely, faith is a big part of my life. So I think that's where I get a lot of my, where I like to ground myself and start every day, just by doing like a devotional and prayer and just kind of centering my mind on something bigger than myself. And I think that's where I find my energy and like my strength. And just that sort of perspective to like love your neighbor as yourself and go through the day like that.
Do you go to church? Do you do that?
Yeah. Yeah. And I love it. And it's such a great community. But I mean, everybody finds their own thing. You know, it's all like a process of your journey in your life of like finding what grounds you, what makes you thrive, what brings you happiness. And oftentimes I think what brings you happiness is when you're not focused on yourself.
I think it's a great point. And, you know, I was going to say, another tweet of yours, you ask these great questions, I think, to young people. Which organizations have you seen make a positive difference in your communities? Hashtag 50 States for Good. I mean, if you had one tip for any of the, you know, young people watching, millennials watching, that look to you as a role model and, you know, want to be able to help, want to give back a little bit more, what would you say to them?
I would say, figure out what are you most passionate about, and that's a hard question to ask. So see what makes you most angry? What do you get like heated about and want to change? And then go after that. And then you'll be working to fight, and then you're fighting for something that really matters to you.
Oh, I think that's a really good advice. AnnaSophia, thank you so much for coming on HuffPost Live today.
So
it's been
much.
Such a pleasure.
This
so such an inspiration to so many people
thanks.
Well. So great to have you. And guys, for more information on AnnaSophia and the 50 States for Good campaign with Toms of Maine, check out our resource well below. And stick around, there's more HuffPost Live coming up next.